Good morning and welcome to our Palm Sunday service here in Acombe Parish in York. We're so pleased that you are joining us in worship today. Our service is slightly unusual in that it's very much broken into two parts, and we move from the first part of celebration to the second part into solemnness as we think of Jesus beginning to set face and head to Jerusalem. Our first part is the commemoration of the Lord's entry into Jerusalem. That's a long title, but it's basically Jesus arrives at Jerusalem. And so we begin with these words from the prophet Zechariah. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. Let's join in this refrain together. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Behold, your King comes to you, O Zion, meek and lowly, sitting upon an ass. Ride on in the cause of truth and for the sake of justice. Your throne is the throne of God. It endures for ever. And the scepter of your kingdom is a righteous scepter. You have loved righteousness and hated evil. Therefore, God, your God has anointed you with the oil of gladness above your fellows. And we say together, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We're going to sing together now, and Karis and Tony are going to lead us in two songs of worship linked together. Let's praise God in song together.
You are the King of glory. You are the Prince of peace. You are the Lord of heaven and earth. You're the Son of righteousness.
Hosanna, Hosanna,
of kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God. Glory to the King of kings.
You will have noticed, hopefully, that there's a traditional palm cross on the wall behind me. And of course, at this time of year, we would be handing out palm crosses, but not this year because of COVID. I have here yet a different type of palm cross. These are made by women from Bangladesh, and they're made for CMS, the Church Mission Society. Some of you may have had these previous years. Well, instead of palm crosses this year, when I wrote to members of our church just before Lent began, I invited people to draw or to colour in crosses that they could place on their windows during Lent so that they could proclaim the cross of Christ to those who passed by. So instead of holding up palm crosses today, I'm going to ask us to think about those palm crosses, or those crosses rather, that we have placed on our windows. And as we do so, we pray this prayer together. God, our Saviour, whose Son Jesus Christ entered Jerusalem as Messiah to suffer and to die, let the crosses on our windows be to all who pass by signs of his victory, and grant that we who display them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's also join in our collect prayer for today, Palm Sunday. So we pray. True and humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us the faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way of the cross, which is the path of glory. Amen. We're going to have our first reading today, the Palm Gospel, and this is read for us by Susan.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it and will send it back here immediately.' And they went away and found a colt tied at a door outside in the street, and they untied it. And some of those standing there said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' And they told them what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he. Blessed is the kingdom coming to our father David. Hosanna in the highest.' And he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
In a few moments, I'm delighted that Andrew is going to share with us this morning in the light of that Palm Gospel. And thank you, Susan, for reading it. At the end of the sermon, there's going to be a choral piece of music, which is an opportunity for us to reflect upon Andrew's words. But first, let's join in our next hymn together. Ride on, ride on in majesty.
Imagine a British gold medal winner returning to their hometown after the Olympics. There's often been an open-top bus, banners, flags waved by cheering crowds lining the streets, a patriotic fervour and a carnival atmosphere. The events described in that first reading were a bit like that. Only instead of flags and banners, people were shinning up trees to cut down branches to throw on the processional route, and were spreading their cloaks in the road too. And instead of an open-top bus, the hero rode on a donkey. Different times, different culture, but the same excitement. It happened on what we've come to know as Palm Sunday, because John, in his Gospel, mentions the palm branches people waved. These events took place on Sunday. The reading we shall hear later describes events which took place on Friday, Good Friday. What a contrast, as we shall see, between the events which took place at the beginning and the end of that fateful week. On Palm Sunday, adopting a prearranged plan, as Jesus approaches Jerusalem with crowds of other pilgrims coming up for the Jewish Passover festival, he sends two of his followers on ahead to borrow the donkey, which he mounts to ride down the Mount of Olives and into the city of Jerusalem. How excited Jesus' disciples must have been. Up to now, he told them to keep his identity secret. Now, at last, they see him deliberately seeking the limelight through his extraordinary demonstration and staking a dramatic claim. It was that donkey. You see, he was acting out some words of the Old Testament prophet Zechariah. Do not be afraid, Jerusalem. Here comes your king, riding on a young donkey. Everyone knew that verse, and everyone knew it referred to the Messiah, the king who was coming to deliver his people and establish his rule of justice, freedom, and peace. The disciples must have been on a high as they basked in his reflected glory and wondered what he would do next. But for all the excitement and bank holiday atmosphere, Jesus was presenting a serious challenge. Someone has written, "The time for decision had come. Jerusalem must crown or crucify her king." Fast forward shortly to our second reading from Sunday to Friday. But not before we recognize that there's a challenge here for us too. Are we serious about our own allegiance to Jesus? Or, as Bishop Tom Wright puts it, have we so trivialized our Christian commitment that we look on Jesus simply as someone to help us through the various things we want to do anyway? Not accustomed to monarchs with real power, he goes on, have we forgotten what, in biblical terms, a true king might be like? Come, O Christ, enter our world, our nation, our homes, our lives. Make yourself known, and make your conquest ever more complete among us. For your love's sake. Amen.
God shows his love for us in that, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And as we prepare to share a prayer together, as we come to confess, to say sorry to the Lord for all that we know that won't have pleased him in our lives, let's have a moment of silent reflection. And as we offer ourselves again, we pray together. My God, for love of you, I desire to hate and forsake all sins by which I have ever displeased you. And I resolve by the help of your grace to commit them no more and to avoid all opportunities of sin. Help me to do this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring you his pardon and his peace now and forever. Amen. There is a change of mood at this point in the service. In Lent, we were preparing by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today, we begin a solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters his own city to complete his work as our Saviour, to suffer, to die, and to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love through this Holy Week, so that united with him in his sufferings, we may share his risen life. And so we come to the second part of our service in which the mood changes. We come to what's called the Liturgy of the Word. Tony is shortly going to read our Passion Gospel, and this is quite a long Gospel reading, very important though, so please be patient as we listen to this reading that Tony gives us. Following that, Andrew is going to share with us again two sermons today. That's a bonus. And then again, as a moment of reflection after Andrew's words, we have the hymn, Man of Sorrows. So, over to Tony.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. And as soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council, and they bound Jesus and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate. And Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And he answered him, "You have said so." And the chief priests accused him of many things, and Pilate again asked him, "Have you no answer to make? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, at the feast, he used to release for them one prisoner for whom they asked. And among the rebels in prison, who had committed murder in the insurrection, there was a man called Barabbas. And the crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do as he usually did for them. And he answered them, saying, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he perceived that it was out of envy that the chief priests had delivered him up. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release for them Barabbas instead. And Pilate again said to them, Then what shall I do with the man you call the King of the Jews? And they cried out again, Crucify him! And Pilate said to them, Why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, Crucify him! So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. And the soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole battalion. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on him. And they began to salute him, Hail, King of the Jews! And they were striking his head with a reed, and spitting on him, and kneeling down in homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, and put his own clothes on him, and they led him out to crucify him. And they compelled a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots for them to decide what each should take. And it was the third hour when they crucified him. And the inscription of the charge against him read, The King of the Jews. And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, Ah, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross. So also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him to one another, saying, He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe. Those who were crucified with him also reviled him. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, Behold, he is calling Elijah. And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down. And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, Truly, this man was the Son of God. This is the Passion of the Lord.
I hinted in the first part of the talk at the striking contrast between the events described by Mark in his Gospel on the Sunday and the Friday of the last week of Jesus' earthly life. Palm Sunday was full of excitement, anticipation, and joy. Our second reading from Friday, full of disappointment, derision, hopelessness, ending in the cruel, agonizing death of Sunday's hero. If we'd read the chapters in between, we should have seen the dignity and steadfast, faithful dedication of Jesus, and the short-sighted fickleness, selfishness, and fear of the rest of the characters in the drama. Yes, the Gospel's account of the arrest, trial, and crucifixion of Jesus has been described as the greatest drama ever written. Some of you, like me, will have watched at the bedside of a loved one who was dying. They're too ill to recover. It's only a matter of time. And the waiting drags wearily on. and you feel so helpless. But everything is done to keep the patient comfortable and free from pain. And if it's in hospital, the nursing staff attend to your needs too. The Gospel writers are restrained in their description of Jesus' last hours. We can barely begin to imagine the searing pain, the heat, the flies, the gasping for breath, the agonizing cramp, and the waiting, the helpless waiting of the faithful women who alone were present, watching from a distance. The author of our drama portrays various incidents between 9 a.m. and 3 p.m. to convey this weary passage of time. At 9, Jesus is offered drugged wine as a primitive painkiller, but refuses. It seems he wants to remain in full control of his faculties as he battles with the sin of the world. He's fastened to the cross, and the cross hoisted into position. His long agony has begun. We see the mocking irony of the notice conveying his charge, the King of the Jews. We recognize three men for execution, three crosses, and Jesus allotted the central cross. They crucified two robbers with him, says Mark, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus, who'd come to invite sinners, was one with sinners in his death. There followed the insults of the crowd and the jeering of the religious leaders. He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. More dramatic irony here. The chief priests had spoken truer than they knew. They meant their words as Jesus' condemnation. In fact, they were Jesus' glory. He did save others, and to do so, he had to sacrifice himself. All this he did for you and me. As the hymn says, bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood. Time drags on. The sun rises in the sky and gets hotter. It's noon. And just when the sun is at its highest, the sky clouds over. Was it coincidence that the sun was darkened in the face of the greatest crime of the human race, the murder of the Son of God? Nothing seems to be happening. Had many in the crowds got bored and drifted off? Time goes slowly by. At 3, in the gloom, some bystanders hear Jesus cry out. His exact words in Aramaic were remembered and recorded by Mark, no doubt for the astonishing things he expressed. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? It's to Mark's credit he, alone, recorded these words of abandonment and despair. He might have wanted to hush up words that emphasized Jesus' weakness and helplessness. Had Jesus really felt himself cut off from God? It was not the physical suffering and pain, not the degradation and shame, not the loneliness and desolation, which is the most significant aspect of Jesus' death. Others have borne these things. Jesus alone lived all his life in unwavering faith and joyful obedience to his heavenly Father, and now suddenly found that God too had vanished. Such was the effect of the evil that had closed in on Jesus, which he was bearing. In fact, Mark indicates a kind of progression of abandonment that Jesus experienced until finally he asks, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus' utter and complete aloneness in a hostile world was the price of achieving the full salvation of others. But because of this cry of desolation, we know that Jesus has plumbed the depths of every most bitter human experience. Now we know that Jesus hears us, is with us, not only when life is bright and sunny, but when life is at its toughest, when we too feel alone and abandoned in a hostile world. Then, we read, Jesus gave a loud cry and died. The long wait is over. The end has come. And almost at once, the consequences of Jesus' death begin to appear. Satisfied their enemy was dead, I can imagine the chief priests and lawyers turning to walk away, when a messenger suddenly rushes up with the astonishing news that in the temple just a few minutes before, he'd witnessed the curtain concealing the holiest place torn in two from top to bottom. Mark's readers in every age have seen this as a sign of Jesus' death, that with Jesus' death, a new direct access to God is opened up. There's another utterly improbable consequence of Jesus' death. Among the bystanders was the Roman centurion, senior NCO in charge of the detachment of soldiers on execution duty that day. He must have been used to watching criminals dying on the crosses that lined many a road in the Roman provinces. For him, it was all part of a day's work. But this victim was different. The centurion hadn't seen how Jesus lived. But when he saw how Jesus died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God?" And there, so to speak, the curtain on our drama falls. It seems to be the final curtain, but of course it's not. For in a few hours' time, Jesus will rise again, his victory over death complete. In fact, the curtain that really matters is the one in the temple, now split in two, so as to open wide the way into the very presence of our holy God. And on Easter Day, it's not the curtain merely, but the stone guarding Jesus' body, which will be gloriously swept aside. As for our dramatist, Mark has not written a biography of Jesus, nor a history. He's written a gospel, a good news. He's not impartial. He himself has heard the good news, responded to it, and is caught up in his account. He writes to help others, to help us to see, to believe, to come to the standpoint of the centurion and go beyond, so that we might say with St. Paul, "The life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me."
Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God, who came ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Saviour. Bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed by pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Saviour. Guilty, vile and helpless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement can it be. Hallelujah, what a Saviour. Lifted up was he to die, it is finished was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high, hallelujah, what a Saviour. When he comes, the glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew his song we'll sing. Hallelujah, what a Saviour.
Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Listen to this prayer from Good Friday. Eternal God, in the cross of Jesus we see the cost of sin and the depth of your love. In humble hope and fear, may we place at his feet all that we have and all that we are, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now Ali is going to lead us in our intercessions. Let's pray.
Father, as Palm Sunday is here, and this past year has brought trying and unknown times and flashes of fear that none of us have experienced in our lifetimes, the very fallen state of our world and frailty of life have been put front and centre in our lives in a visceral way. We look to you, Father, to guide us out of fear and remind us of our Saviour. We do not need to be afraid. You have given us the wisdom we need to live each day of our lives to the full purpose you have designed for us to live. Father, Palm Sunday is a reminder of the unexpected yet fully anticipated King of Kings. Jesus did not look like the Messiah your people had hoped for, the way he entered the holy city of Jerusalem on that day, riding a young donkey, as a significant sign of peace and fulfillment of prophecy, did not align with their expectations of a military conqueror. Much of our daily lives don't align with our expectations, Father. So much of our lives don't make sense. This Palm Sunday, let us embrace the unexpected entrance of our Saviour Jesus. He is peace. Let us apply this incredible truth to our lives. Peace mattered to Jesus. He came to bring us peace. He is peace. Father, how quickly we forget the peace we possess in Christ. Remind us minute by minute as we navigate difficult days and trying times. Father, we need peace to live life to the full, as Jesus died for us to live. Jesus knew, riding into the holy city, amidst pomp and circumstance, what he would have to face in the coming days. How many of us wouldn't want to carry on if we knew the worst possible ending was inevitable? He continued on to accomplish your will. In peace, not panic. Though he passionately cried tears of blood, asking that there be another way, he obediently and peacefully walked to the cross because it was the only way. We can walk through trouble, trial, and pain because our Saviour sustains us. He has already walked the most difficult path and died to defeat the death we deserve. All of the pain we experience on this earth is temporary, for those who embrace him as Saviour will be eternally with him in heaven. No pain, no suffering, no sickness, no death. Imagine the peaceful parade, palms waving as he returns once again to free us completely. When we are hurting, struggling, or overwhelmed, Father, I pray we can embrace the scene of Palm Sunday in all of its significance, in order to fuel a hope in us that will drive us on day after day, in peace-filled pursuit of your purpose for our lives. Father, we confess today our sins, specifically forgetting you, neglecting to remember and let Jesus' sacrifice resonate with us. Jesus, you are closer than we could ever possibly understand. We confess worry, for we know you say it does us no good. Even still, we worry and become anxious daily. We confess our lack of care and love for every one of us, no, for other people you have placed in our lives. Father, our Saviour laid down his life for every one of us centuries before we would ever walk the earth. In the same sacrificial way, let us be willing to take up our crosses daily and lay down our lives for people you have placed in them. Thank you, Father, for the life you have given us to live, for the sun rising to start another day, and the reminders of your creation surrounding us. When we witness a beautiful mark of your creative hand, let us recall that Christ was with you too when the world began at the sound of your voice. He eventually came to earth and watched the same sunrise we now see. He looked into the stars in the sky and now looks down on us, prayerfully, with love. With grateful hearts, we praise you, God, for you, for who you are and who we are in you. Let the peace of Christ's Palm Sunday entrance remain in our memories. We are fearful and anxious. help us to recall the peace in which Jesus rode into the city so soon after to be crucified. God, our Father, help us to act in grace and peace in the face of fear, both known and unknown, knowing you are incredibly close. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Don't forget that there's also an Easter trail around the churchyard at St. Stephen's. And in case I don't see you or hear from you over Easter itself or Holy Week, may I take this opportunity to wish you a happy Easter. We're going to share the peace together. Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And if you're watching this service with somebody else in the room, then please share the peace with each other now. We're going to sing again. And this is a lovely hymn sung for us by Graham Kendrick and his band. Amazing Love. Let's sing.
Amazing love, oh, what sacrifice.
Now, just before the blessing, may I thank you again for joining us in worship today. And if you would like any information about the church here in Acombe, or you would like somebody to talk to or to pray with you, then please do get in touch through our website, or perhaps join us at a church service. But remember, you need to book for those. May the Father, who so loved the world that he gave his only Son, bring you by faith to his eternal life. Amen. May Christ, who accepted the cup of sacrifice in obedience to the Father's will, keep you steadfast as you walk with him the way of the cross. Amen. May the Spirit, who strengthens us to suffer with Christ, that we may share his glory, set your minds on life and peace. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Let's say the next few words together. May Christ, who bore our sins on the cross, set us free to serve him with joy. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.